Renmore Pantomime, celebrating 25 years, 1979 to 2005. This documentary was made with arts funding provided by the Galway County Council, the Galway City Council, and the documentary was facilitated by the Galway Film Centre. Renmore today is a thriving and beautiful suburb of Galway City. The parish church nestles beside acres of lush green open space. Gentle waves lap the shores of Ballylochon Beach. Renmore is indeed a garden of delight, the environmental jewel in the city crown. Over 30 years ago, young couples from all over the country came to live in this newly built estate. It was 1978 when the seed was sown for Renmore Pantomime. At that time, the school assembly hall was our only social centre. Here in the tiny kitchen, Sean O'Malley suggested to his teammates in the Renmore Badminton Club that they should consider having a parish pantomime. A marvellous community spirit swept the project along, and Goody Two Shoes was launched at the Jesuit School Hall, Sea Road, Galway, on the 6th of January 1979. That first production made an immediate impact. The planned three-night run had to be extended to five. The momentum gathered pace in the following years for Jack and the Beanstalk and Aladdin. The Jez Hall could no longer cater for the crowds, so we moved to Leisureland in 1982 for Old King Cole. The huge Leisureland Auditorium presented a new challenge. A cast of thousands became the slogan of the day. Favourable reviews and newspaper headlines generated great interest. The roller coaster of successes continued. In 1996, we moved into the refurbished Town Hall Theatre. Over the past 26 years, about 1,200 performers have taken part. It has attracted support from local and faraway places. It has entertained audience numbers in excess of 100,000. The Renmore Pantomime is now part of the family entertainment calendar for the first 2 weeks of every January. We are very fortunate in Renmore Pantomime to have a dynamic administrator in Mary Barrett. She drives the production throughout the whole year with great energy and enthusiasm.
When the pantomime finishes in the middle of January, I would immediately start and book the town hall for the following year. Me and my committee would then sit down and discuss scripts at our monthly meetings. We would pick a show for the following year, and I would continue to liaise with the sponsors of the show and make sure everybody's on board for the following year.
And Babes in the Wood.
Come September, we would have open auditions and rehearsals would start in earnest. And by December, when we would have our press launch, everything is almost ready for our move into the town hall.
Back in 94, 93, Joe Astor would be take over the mantle as directors, which we were delighted to take on the challenge of it. So ever since then to the current year, we have been directors of the pantomime. At that time, things were changing in terms of the frontline performers were changing, and as well as dancers, and people were growing up and getting older and moving on. So to keep people involved, which has changed a few things in terms of how a pantomime should be run. We put our own mark on it, if you like. We cut the shows down to about 2.5 hours and try to get a bit more variety and get moving on. The interreaction between the performers and the audience was something that was well established in the early years with the likes of Jerry Ferguson as the Dame and other people, John Ford as the evil or the witch.
When the adults come to see a pantomime, I think they get two shows. I think the first show is what's on stage, which is what we're all doing. But the second show is them watching their own children or other children react, you know, to what's going on stage. And I think you have to engage your audience. And there's only one way you can do that, through your dames and through your baddies, who have huge amount of sort of scope within the script, that they can go outside that box and basically work the audience.
I remember kids that come to you after a show and they'd say, "You're a man," like as if they were the ones that discovered it. Father Jack O'Connor actually asked me, would I ever help Joe McCarthy, that he was putting on a pantomime. And I was a bit kind of put out when Joe kind of says, "You're the man for the dame," because I couldn't imagine myself being a dame. And over the years, it just kind of grew on me, and I'd meet people in the shopping centre and they'd kind of look up and they'd say, "Oh, you're the dame," because they didn't know my face really, but the voice kind of tipped them off. I really enjoyed it, because a dame is kind of brash and says naughty words like knickers every now and then, so I reckon that's how you got the guys on your side, because you used these few naughty words that their mothers wouldn't let them.
Get back out again.
No, don't worry. Your safety is my first concern. Now, in you go, right, dear boy.
So one particularly, I remember somebody saying to me, "Look, we need somebody to do a baddie in the Renmore pantomime." And all along to the years in the Tyvek, I was doing the goody parts and the nice parts, and I always wanted to do a baddie. It was one of my ambitions to do a baddie part. So when Joe came along and said, "Ah, we want you to do Dragfoot, this is the guy, the hunchback, like the hunchback of Notre Dame," I said, "Yep, spot on, I'll have a go at that." So we're going along, and at that time, the pantomime, I think, was in the Jazz Hall, was it? Particularly, I'm not quite sure. Or was it Legend? But I remember at the time, I got dickied up, and I had my pillow up, I had my big scars, and really got going. So I said to Joe, I said, "This would be a nice idea for a little bit of audience participation." He said, "How do you mean?" I said, "You know, if I go down at the audience, get them involved, and, you know, get them to boo me and really have a go back at them." And he said, "Oh, I don't know, but, you know, we might take the scary thing a little bit too far, like, you know." So we decided to give it a go, and it actually worked.
Oh, yes, he should!
A good baddie, I think, is really, he's got to be very, very convincing, and he's got to appear to be quite bad and nasty, and really kind of get the kids a little bit weary of him. And then, of course, as they go down, they know that in the heel of the hunt, you know, good is going to win over evil, and then when he gets his comeuppance, they're all very, very convinced. But the idea then afterwards that the baddie is actually met by the audience, they can go down and shake hands with him and see that he really isn't that bad.
It's not just about going on the stage, cracking the joke and getting the laugh. It is important. Your feedback is immediate. If people laugh, you know they're on your side. If they don't, you know you have to work harder, maybe change the gag, change the timing. But that's the finished product. It's the work that goes into maybe making the character, picking the accent. What kind of background does this character have? Are they going to talk with a funny voice? Do you keep that up the whole way through the show? How are they going to look with makeup? And it's at a very early stage in the rehearsals, believing that you are that character.
Are you with old Jackie? Am I to be?
I suppose my biggest kick out of it is not just because it's a sense of satisfaction. And as I say, making people laugh is something hopefully that I like to do. But it's what the kids get out of it, and it's what you get back from those kids. It has to be about the kids. And it's their involvement in it that makes it special.
My first pantomime I was in Old Kincole, and I was only 4 years of age, and anybody under a certain age wore yellow. We were delighted with our yellow, and then the older girls wore pink and green. And I remember having to be put to bed before being brought to Leisureland, even though I didn't want to go, just for a rest before we went out.
I started in the panto when I was about 6 years old.
went from being a chicken to a cowgirl to a French maid in about 3 years.
At lunchtime in the playground, we used to practice all the dances. And then, of course, the excitement when it got closer, and we had the dress rehearsals and all of the rehearsals through Christmas period.
It's energetic, it's fun, you meet so many people. There's about 100 of you in the cast, and you build up friendships. Because you're rehearsing from October till after January, it's 3 or 4 months.
And then, of course, the night of the panto itself, when you got to perform and put on the makeup, and just when you're that small, the excitement was something else, really.
The anticipation backstage, it was so dark, and there was a long line. There was a lot of Smurfs in those times. I think there could have been, I don't know, it felt like 100 of us, but we were all queued up in our lines, ready to go on when our music cue was. And we went out, and I remember the lights being blinding just for that moment, and then you had to get on, you know, the music was going.
Even when I was so young, it was just so exciting standing on the stage in Leisureland in front of about 1,000 people, and just the buzz was phenomenal. I'd love to go for Prince Will. Maybe train the voice now for a while and see how it goes, but I'd love to go from, I've been the Smurf, I'm still a dancer, and I'd love to do the Prince Will.
Well, I suppose every little girl wants to be a princess. And I loved it. I felt very special. And I had the opportunity to dress up. And I had the opportunity to get my handsome prince.
To me, being a princess in the Renmore Pantomime now would be like winning the Rose of Tralee. If you say it's nothing good enough, I would give
my world to lift you up. I would change my life. Once upon a time, at the beginning of pantomime, we made nearly everything that went on stage, and then we progressed to hiring the principals. We always had, of course, with Joe McCarthy at the time, you'd have to have 96 Smurfs, or it wasn't any good. But we always made every one of those. But the parents were always brilliant. All the parents of the Smurfs were always brilliant.
I've been involved in the panto, I think, actually since the start, and I would have been there for most years, up for about a good 20 years anyway. But one big thing I remember was a lot of family involvement. Sometimes there were whole families involved. And eventually these people would be group leaders or team leaders. And the great thing also, it was like a kind of a mobile youth club that would go on from September to Christmas every year. And even some people would describe it as a kind of a FOSS scheme, where people handed on their crafts or skills to the younger generation. But a good healthy thing about it, I thought, was the mix of the younger and the older people. And you could have in a team of, say, the props team, you could have somebody from the Garda Síochána and teachers, and maybe some wild young fellow from the parish or whatever. It opened up a whole new world for lots of young people. And down through the years, then I would be still in the music business myself, so I would have played in musicals and shows, and I saw them coming through from the panto, and you'd know them when they came into the musicals from the good grounding they got, the stagecraft they'd learned in the panto. The great thing about the people, and I won't, they know who they are, but I won't embarrass anybody by naming them, but it got to a stage where they empowered the other people to come along and take over, and that was the strength of it. They passed on the skills, as I said, and it empowered the younger people to come up.
As the curtain comes down on Aladdin, we are already planning for our 27th annual pantomime. We look to the future with confidence. We appreciate our large, loyal support, and we know that upcoming talent is eager to take to the stage, break a leg, and to consider themselves one of us.